So yeah, thanks again for the organizer to this great conference. So this work has been done mostly at the CEA-Saclay in Paris, and I moved recently, I mean, last September to Grenoble. So the work that I'm going to talk about today is about spin wave, mostly the work that we've done on MRFM studies of ferromagnets. So as you know, a spin wave is a collective excitation of the magnetic system. Okay, it corresponds to the transport of angular momentum into the system. So you can think of it as a magnon. So it's like a spin oriented anti-parallel to the equilibrium system that is being carried through the system. And you have two components, DC and AC components. The AC component is usually the one that is detected and rotates at the Larmor frequency. Okay, and here I use a coding. I'm going to use consistently a coding system where the phase is coded with the color, and you will see it's useful. The DC component, okay, corresponds to a second order effect in the counting, in the opening cone angle that you do in the precession. And well, of course, the AC component is a first order. And usually, this cone angle in typical FMR experiment is very, very small. And the reason why it's very, very small is that you don't want the change of internal field, because it's intrinsically a nonlinear system. As soon as you open the cone angle, you decrease the internal magnetization. And you don't want this to exceed the line width, okay? Which can be as small as a couple of Gauss, for example, in some magnetic insulators. So contrary to what you do in a paramagnetic system, we do a very small excitation of a collective mode. Okay, and so what we do with a magnetic resonance force microscopy, and actually most of the technique that I know, we detect actually the DC part of the spin wave. So what we do is we turn on and off the microwave at the mechanical frequency, and therefore we code inside a mechanical motion whatever spin wave motion that we have induced in our sample. Okay. I would like to point out a recent work that has been done at the University of Edmonton by Mark Freeman, which was using torsional mechanical oscillators, and he has detected using vortex motion spin waves at the Larmor frequency. So he has been able to detect the AC component of a spin wave. Okay. Now, because it's the DC, we coupled dipolarly a magnetic sphere on a cantilever, so therefore we can study buried objects, and this technique has been actually people have been very interested in this technique for spintronics, where it's important, for example, to study a device that is as close as possible to the final device, and usually, for example, it has contact electrodes on top of it. So the fact that we have a technique that can detect through the dipolar interaction buried object has been quite useful. Okay. Notice that usually, so what the particle that we put on the tip of a cantilever is a sphere. And here I show you a very nice work that has been done in collaboration, I should have put the name, with José María de Teresa at the University of Zaragoza, which can synthesize actually cobalt nanoparticle right at the tip of a cantilever using an electron beam. So basically, you do a catalysis of a cobalt carbon gas. And by rotating his beam, he can synthesize almost a perfect sphere. And the quality of so it's a cobalt carbon, but the quality of a cobalt is pretty good. Huh? It's about the magnetization that you get is very close to, it's 80% made of cobalt, and it's amorphous. So most of the talk that I'm going to most of my talk is going to focus on the issue of measuring the damping in a ferromagnet and what it means. So these are MRFM spectra that we've done back in 2008 on permaloid disks, okay? So usually you shine your microwave at a very particular frequency, for example here 5.8 gigahertz, and what you do is you sweep the magnetic field, and for a particular, of course, when you hit the Larmor resonance, you see a big movement of a cantilever, and what you do is you excite usually the most uniform mode in your system. Okay? And you see higher harmonics at higher field, and I'll come back to that. And usually, when you if you follow, okay, first this peak you see is here at as a nice Lorentzian shape, and if you follow this peak as it goes to, as you increase the frequency of excitation, so first it moves to higher field, this is just due to the geomagnetic ratio, but you see that the line width also broadens, and if you follow the line width as a function of frequency, it follows usually, at least on at the higher frequency, it follows a slope, okay? This slope is linked to what is called the Gilbert parameter. It's a phenomenological way of describing at the microscopic level the equation of motion of the magnetization, okay? And it usually intercepts the origin. What we call, okay, by the way, what we call usually the slope, okay, the slope is linked to the variation of the broadening, field broadening divided by the frequency. This slope is linked in only in the perpendicular direction where you have a perfectly circular rotation is linked to directly to the Gilbert damping coefficient. Notice that usually as you go down in the perpendicular direction, as you go down in frequency, usually you have a point that go off scale, and this is just an effect that is linked usually to a texturing of the magnetic system. It's not that the damping coefficient has changed, but the apparent broadening that you see is enhanced by spatial texturing in the system. You can have effect that is also due if you tilt the angle of the magnetic field compared to the normal. Okay. Usually, as you tilt this angle, you introduce also an additional broadening due to the ellipticity. And usually, the slope recovers the damping coefficient if you arrive exactly in plane. Okay, now, if you measure this coefficient in different materials, usually there is, this is the rule of thumb. If you have, so usually you need to have the material with very low coercivity. If you take the alloy with the lowest damping known coefficient, it's permalloy. It's a nickel iron alloy. And the damping coefficient is about better than 10 times to the minus 2. If you go to a monocrystal, usually you improve the coefficient. And the best known metallic, lowest damping metallic system is iron. This is the case of iron vanadium, where you have 2 times 10 to the minus 3. If you decrease the electronic density, usually also for a monocrystal, you improve the damping. This is the case of Oessler alloy. It's a half metal, and you go down to 10 to the minus 3. And the lowest damping that has been observed are in magnetic insulators. And this is the case of YIG, yttrium iron garnet. Okay, which has actually the peculiarity of having very small spin-orbit interaction inside, and it has a damping of 5 times 10 to the minus 5, and people are very interested, I mean, people have found application for this material. You can find it in Yttrium oscillator or circulator very low loss. You know that magnetic materials are very useful in microwave properties for non-reciprocal properties like isolator or circulators. Okay, and the best material usually use this garnet, non-reciprocal device. You can find it as also as delay line and so forth. Okay. Very recently, okay, you have to know that people have discovered a way of manipulating the damping coefficient through what is called spin transfer. By injecting angular momentum in the system is a way of actually electronically changing, either increasing or decreasing the damping coefficient. This has been ongoing research for quite a while in metallic system, where what you do is you use multi-layer system and you inject a current perpendicular to the plane. We call it CPP current. Current perpendicular to the plane, which transfer angular momentum between different layers by basically using the fact that electrons are spin polarized near the Fermi surface, and they transfer by using the charge current, you transfer also the spin current between layers. This has been well characterized, but this was restricted, intrinsically restricted to metal system. Very recently, oops, what did I do? Should be careful. More recently, people have discovered by revisiting the effect of spin hole effect that there is a way of injecting a current perpendicular to the plane, a spin current perpendicular to the plane, using an in-plane charge current, using the spin hole effect. And the spin hole effect basically linked the deflection of a trajectory of an electron depending on its direction of rotation. And this is, for example, you can find it in many classical mechanics. In soccer, this is an example in pool, where, for example, by hitting the ball vertically, this is actually a trick that you should be very careful because you might create a hole, in the pool. But by being very careful by hitting this white ball vertically, okay, you can deflect the trajectory and go around these red balls. And the nice thing, is that a charge current is linked to a spin current through a cross product, but only if, okay, and this cross product is the following. So for example, if I have a charge current in the x direction, and I want to introduce a spin current in the z direction, my only choice is to inject a spin current that is polarized in the y direction. Now the nice thing of having this cross product rule is that in principle, you can inject spin current by inside an insulator by injecting in an adjacent layer a charge current along the layer. So you can do spin transfer now in what is called the CIP, geometric current in plane. Okay. Now, do magnetic insulator talk, or is it possible to transfer spin current in a magnetic insulator? If you take a material such as yttrium iron garnet, 10 nanometer in thickness, and you put just 3 nanometer of platinum on top of it, you see a huge increase, actually almost a factor of 3 or 4, in the damping coefficient in the slope. This is the signature, but actually, so the way we understand it is called spin pumping. This is a signature that actually spin is being transferred between the two layers. So basically, if you create a spin wave in YIG, it can cross the interface and be absorbed in the platinum layer. And this spin being transferred in the platinum being a strong spin orbit metal, is completely absorbed. All right? And you see that actually it's a very dominant phenomenon, that actually the YIG being at such a low damping material, the dominant channel of relaxation becomes the fact that the angular momentum disappears through the interface and be absorbed. So you can actually monitor or parameterize how much transparency you have for spin current between the interface. It's through what is called a spin mixing conductance, and it's through this enhancement of the damping. And this is the signature that actually a magnetic insulator, you can do through a metal transmission of angular momentum to a magnetic insulator, this damping experiment. And this is intrinsically an interfacial effect. So it's very important that your ferromagnet has the smallest thickness as possible. So very recently, people have done a renewed effort to develop thin film of YIG of very low thickness and try to see this effect of spin transfer through the inside YIG. Notice that the effect, okay, is linked also to not only the thickness of a ferromagnet, but also its damping coefficient. And this damping coefficient being dominated already by the interface, okay, you see that if you calculate, so what, for example, how much spin current I need to inject in my system, for example, to completely compensate the damping, the fact that you're already completely dominated by the interface, you see that by developing very good thin films of about 20 nanometer, okay, you have almost achieved the optimization of a system. That means there is no it's not necessary to go to extremely low thickness, okay, to go to zero thickness, by going to infinitely small thickness, you're not going to improve much because, okay, since being this relaxation time being already dominated by the interface, by the coupling to the system, okay, you are basically improving by a mere, for example, 10% by decreasing, for example, between 25 and zero thickness. Okay, so people have concentrated in building very good film of about 20 nanometer yield with extremely high quality, high quality or very low damping coefficient. Okay, this has been a research effort which has led to a new area where we try to do a spin transfer to magnetic insulator. And there were so in this idea there were two very important things: the fact that now we were doing spin transfer to non-metals, so this has created a great excitement because this opens spintronics to oxides. And another very peculiarity of the fact that you are using a current in plane is that in principle, since your current in plane is in plane, it's a regenerative effect. You could compensate the damping on all the path of the current, so on very large sample. Well, before, the fact that you were using a current perpendicular to plane, you were intrinsically limited to nanopillars. Okay. And people have been very excited. And it turns out that, so if you do an experiment, like you excite your system with a microwave system, for example, a microwave field, you excite a spin wave inside, so you inject angular momentum inside the ferromagnet, the Yig. This angular momentum is going to cross the interface and be transformed inside the interface in a charge current. So there is a very easy way now to detect ferromagnetic inside Yig by looking at the voltage that is being created transversely. And this is called the inverse spinal effect. So you create a spin current in Yig, it's transmitted to the spin current in platinum, which is then transferred in a charge current in platinum through this parameter that is called the spin angle. Okay, and usually the signature is that if you measure the voltage, you measure a big peak of voltage at the ferromagnetic resonance. And by symmetry, this voltage is inverted. This is, for example, the blue line. Let's say the blue line, this is for platinum. This voltage is inverted when you invert the direction of the magnetic field. And notice that this voltage is quite large. It's a microvolt for samples that are in the millimeter region. So it's a huge effect. It's purely a spinal effect. For example, you can take a material like tantalum, which has a spinal angle that is negative, and you completely invert the signature of a voltage that is being degenerated. Okay, if this is the intrinsic effect, there should be the reciprocal, okay, just by Onsager relation. That means if my damping is being controlled by, I should be able to control my damping by a charge current. That means if I inject a charge current inside my system, okay, I should create a spin current inside the platinum, and through this spin current inside the platinum, exerts a torque that should act on the damping. This is the spin pumping was an effect on this, an effect on electrical conductivity and damping. So I should be able to control electrically the damping, and this was the system that people use in nanopillar as a way of controlling the damping. If you do it in Yig. Okay, and this is the experiment we are done on millimeter size samples, you observe nothing. And this has been a very puzzling problem to the community for the last 5 years. And I'm going to show you what MRFM has been has brought to understand what is the underneath physics and the way to solve this problem. So actually, if you take a piece of thin film of Yig, and you look at the resonance at, for example, this is in place at 10 gigahertz, you see that the line width is very small. Okay, it's about 2 gauss. Usually, Yig on GGG, okay, its damping parameter is 10 to the minus 4. And by the way, it's mostly dominated, okay, by the coupling to the GGG. Okay, That means that the fact that the Yig is grown on a substrate, this substrate is a paramagnetic fluctuator, okay, and it dominates usually the damping coefficient. That means a Yig sphere isolated will have a much lower damping coefficient than a Yig on a substrate. Okay? And this, for people who are interested in quantum information using Yig as a quantum information, is going to be actually a dominant phenomena at low temperature, and it will spoil completely your system, so it's hopeless to try to use Yig on GGG for quantum information at the moment.
What is GGG?
It's gadolinium gallium garnet. It's another garnet that has almost a perfect matching with the substrate with the crystal. By the way, the Yig is a monster. Huh? The lattice constant is about 1.5 nanometer. It's 15 angstroms. Okay, it's a huge crystal. Okay, and it's okay. Notice also that if you look at the resonance, you notice immediately that it doesn't have on the thin film. This is an experiment done on extended thin film. You will notice immediately that it doesn't have a very good Lorentzian light shape. Okay, and this is very usual. Also, if you measure the line width as a function of frequency, okay, usually you find a finite intercept that is called the inhomogeneous broadening. All right? And a sign of the quality of a Yig that you have is usually this amount of inhomogeneous broadening. Notice that it's about 0.5 Gauss. This is considered as a very good quality thin film. Now, usually what you do in a ferromagnetic resonance is that, so you have your piece of Yig, you bring a uniform microwave field, and you try to excite, because you bring a uniform magnetic field, you try to excite a uniform motion of all your spin inside your system. Okay? Now, there is another way to excite your system. It's called parametric excitation, and this is the following. You take advantage, for example, in plane, that the equation of motion is elliptical. When you are in plane, the depolarization factor in the thickness is different from the depolarization factor in perpendicular to the thickness is different than in the thickness. So the motion in plane, polarized in planes, become elliptical. And when you in magnetism, okay, the length of the vector representing the spontaneous magnetization is usually a conserved quantity. So if you have an elliptical motion, intrinsically, you have a modulation along the precession axis. And notice that this modulation along the precession axis occurs at twice the frequency. So it's possible to excite the FMR mode by pumping the system at twice its frequency, by putting the RF field along the precession axis. And this, the peculiarity of this method is that you don't imprint selection rules. You don't select what is the symmetry of the mode that you excite. And if you do that, okay, this was the line width that you were measuring before with the two Gauss broadening in FMR. This was a diode measurement. If you look at what's going on with the inverse spinel effect, and if here you are looking at the AC component of the inverse spinel effect, okay, created, you see that there are many modes. So that means that within the line width range of your FMR mode, there are many degenerate modes. Well, this is a very well-known phenomena. It comes from what is called the magnon manifold, the way the magnons develop as a function, the dispersion relation of magnons versus k-vector and frequency. And there exist degenerate to your FMR frequency, which is the k equals zero, many modes. Okay, and usually these modes, okay, are coupled to your system through impurities or defect in the surface, and they create an additional relaxation process. So you try to pump usually with uniform precession, but you can have a relaxation channel where you decay in specially inhomogeneous spin waves that are hidden to your frequency. And in the old days, people were describing this as a T1 and T2 phenomenon, because this decay process, basically you keep your system excited, but it has disappeared from the point of view of your coupling to your antenna. Okay, now what happens if you go to the nanoscale? Okay, these are going to be MRFM experiments. So first, these were done on disk, isolated disk, micro disk. This is the measurement again of the extended field film, where you see the non-layer radiant light shape with a line width of 9 megahertz. And if you take this is a 700 nanometer, 0.7 micron diameter, Yig disk, you see that the line width is improving when you pattern it. That means despite the fact that you've created damage, you go through quite an intense process of ion milling, etching, and things like this, the line width of a material improves as you go to microscale. Okay? And we believe that actually this increase of line width, and I'm going to show you, is coming from a removal of the inhomogeneous broadening. Okay. So this is a series of disks where you look at the FMR spectrum as a function of frequency. So as I've said before, what you see is the most intense peaks corresponds to a uniform precession of the spins inside your system. And I represented it in code as all the spins rotating in phase inside the volume. And you can think as an analogy as a membrane vibrating. Now, you can have a higher order mode, which are basically spins where you create nodes along the radial direction. So you have two regions of spins rotating out of phase of each other, okay, separated by a line of node which is represented in white, but where the phase is uniform along the azimuthal direction. But of course, okay, because even in the thin films, you should have also modes in the azimuthal direction. So you have what is called hidden modes, which represents to the coding of a phase in the azimuthal direction. And this is, for example, the L equal one mode. So notice that, okay, so I hope you can see that you have little arrows that represent the transverse magnetization and the one that rotates at the Larmor. All these arrows are all rotating in the same direction. Okay, so they are all rotating here in the trigonometric direction, okay, in the free picture. But here it represents a spin wave that is rotating at the same time that is rotating in the radial along the circumference, either clockwise or counterclockwise. And you can see that the pattern is different. So this will be the L equal one, L equal minus one. And you can have L equal two, L equal three, and also so this will be an index in the azimuthal direction, but you can also repeat the index in the radial direction. And all these are hidden modes. So basically, if you look at the eigenmodes of your system, when you do FMR experiment, actually you shine light on a very particular mode, which are the modes that couple to your RF antenna, and which have non-zero spatial average. So these are the only modes that couple to your antenna, but there exist other modes in the system that are hidden. Okay. Now, there is a very peculiar thing that happens when you do it in the perpendicular direction. If you look at, so this is as a variation of disk diameter. If you look at how it goes, actually, the lowest energy mode, okay, is always, the lowest energy mode is always the FMR mode, okay, and it's always separated. Well separated compared to the others, to the other hidden mode. So the way in the perpendicular direction, the way the spin wave magnon manifold opens up is always on the same side through the higher energy on the same side, on the same wings of the FMR resonance, okay? It always develops on one side of the wing. And this is the fact that I will show you experimental, the fact that this mode is always very well isolated is a recipe for isolating this mode to inhomogeneous broadening. And this is why, usually, when you look at it in the perpendicular direction, when you measure line width versus frequency, intercepts the origin. And this is a typical example on the same Yig disk. So If you measure this, so it's a Yeag platine, if you look at it in the perpendicular direction, the line width as a function of frequency intercepts the origin, but if you will measure it in plane, you will recover a certain amount of inhomogeneous broadening. Why? It's because in plane, things happen differently. In plane, the FMR mode, the most homogeneous mode, is actually surrounded on both sides of its wing by hidden modes of hidden symmetry. And this gets worse, as, for example, as you get to a higher diameter. So you have one mode, actually the mode of the lowest energy is called the edge mode, which corresponds to precession along the edge in the direction of magnetization. Okay. And the most intense peak that at this mode becomes more and more negligible as you increase the diameter. And the most intense peak is actually surrounded by lots of hidden modes that will participate to this inhomogeneous broadening. So the fact that the magnon fanifold now opens up on both sides of the FMR resonance is responsible for this inhomogeneous broadening. Can we study it with MRFM? Can we do induce inhomogeneous broadening? Yes, for example, by looking at how you can disturb the symmetry or induce asymmetry through the tip stray field. So we're going to do experiment where by putting the tip position at different position compared to the axis of symmetry, we are going to do asymmetries in the internal field of a disk and induce this asymmetry will induce intermode coupling. And this intermode coupling will be responsible to the inhomogeneous broadening. These are simulations, okay, of all the eigenmodes of the system. They are shown in black. And what I've put in color, the coupling to a microwave antenna. And what you can see is that the uniform mode is immune intrinsically to any broadening. It's never coupled to any of the modes. While, for example, if you look at the L equal 1, L equal minus 1, as soon as you introduce an asymmetry in the system, okay, this asymmetry basically will couple those two modes. And you see that by coupling these two modes, the fact that this has zero coupling to a uniform microwave field is due to the fact that you have perfect circularity. If I induce imperfect circularity, I will do a linear combination of L equal 1 and L equal minus 1 and introduce a coupling to the uniform microwave field. Now, this coupling is actually, in the case of higher order modes, this coupling is actually done to other adjacent, so modes that are nearly degenerate, and introduce, in this case, additional broadening. And we can see that experimentally by following, for example, So you will put, for example, your tip on the axis of precession and you look at the FMR spectrum. And as soon as you detune it, okay, you can probe, okay, what are the resonance conditions, how you should displace your tip laterally to recreate your resonance condition. So basically, when you detune it, okay, you recover a resonance condition on the ring. And what you can see experimentally, if you look at the uniform mode, the line width of the uniform mode is constant for any detuning. If you look at higher order mode, this is the N equal 1, you see that as your cycle increases, there is another cycle that is created in the middle. You can see it even more broadly, actually on the N equal 2, you see that the first cycle develops, and then you see a second cycle, this is a second cycle that develops, and you see that the third cycle comes out. That means here, by introducing asymmetry, I couple two hidden modes in my system that participate to a broadening and enlarge your system. So this will be what I will call tip-induced inhomogeneous broadening. So the key recipe, again, to try to see the system is try to go to low dimension. If you take a Yeag platinum, so far I've shown you that if you take a millimetric size Yeag platinum there was no effect in the line width. Now, the question is what happens if you try to do it on nanoscale Yick platinum? And this is an experiment where you try to pass a current on a micro-sized disk. This disk is 5 microns, and you can see that at the microscale level, by increasing the through confinement, by increasing the distance, the separation between modes, you can see that by injecting a current, now I can have an effect on the line width. And you can see here what's going on at zero current. So for negative current, you see that your spectrum increases in amplitude and also decreases in line width, while for positive current, it's decrease in amplitude and increase in line width. And you can reverse the effect by inverting the sign of the magnetic field. So you can see that now, by going to a confinement split, by using the confinement as a way to split the degeneracy by through the mode, I'm able now to control the line width. And one key question, that I'm going to show you is that this part of the inhomogeneous broadening was actually what will prevent you to observe the spin transfer in the millimetric size sample. So far, it was believed that when you need to do spin transfer, the amount of current that you needed to inject in the ferromagnet was the amount of current that corresponds to the homogeneous part of the broadening. I'm going to show you experimentally that the amount of current actually that you need to inject in the system is the homogeneous plus inhomogeneous. So the inhomogeneous part play a key role also in deciding where sits this threshold current to control the damping. So this is a pure transport experiment where you pump your system with a microwave excitation, you pump it out of equilibrium, and now you look at it through transport, purely transport. You look at the resonance through the inverse spinel effect. You see this through symmetry, again, this positive and negative signal depending on the direction of a magnetic field. This is for a small disk, 2 microns in diameter. This is for a bigger disk, 4 microns in diameter. And what you can see is you can follow how the line width also develops as a function of diameter. And you see the general trend is that the amount of inhomogeneous broadening that you get depends on the diameter. So the higher is the diameter, okay, the more inhomogeneous broadening have. All these experiments are done by magnetizing plane. Again, to do spin transfer at the moment, I'm obliged to magnetize it plane. And this was the beginning of my talk. That means if I want to do a transverse spin current CPP along here the Z direction, it's mandatory that my spin current be polarized in plane. Okay. And these are, you can put a microwave antenna, for example, around, and you can detect actually for just a pure DC current by plugging to this antenna a spectrum analyzer. You can see that actually the system can, you can compensate enough the damping. Before I was showing you that you could control the line width, actually you can control enough the line width that actually you exactly compensate the line width and the system starts to auto-oscillate and it generates a microwave oscillation. Okay. And you can see that this microwave oscillation only occurs, so if you look at the symmetry field versus current, it only occurs in 2 quadrants of a phase diagram, and this is normal because you need to align the injected spin that you inject into your system. It needs to be anti-parallel to the magnetization. Okay, so this is all consistent with an effect that is due to spinel effect. I'm going to go very quickly. Very little things that I want to say about this oscillation. This is important for application, but you see by using, what's very important is that the generation that the auto-generation line width, okay, is actually around 60 megahertz line width, which shows you that by using an extremely low damping material is not a good way actually of doing an oscillators. Okay? It might be counterintuitive. So using actually a low damping material is very efficient to decrease the threshold current, but it turns out that the generation line width is actually it's about 10 times what is the natural line width of Higgs. So if you will study the line width of Higgs by fMR, the line width will sit around 2 to 4 megahertz at this frequency. And you see here, it goes to a very large angle of precession, and it's mostly due to the fact that actually the angle of precession that I'm inducing in my system is very small, okay? And this is intrinsic, so you see for an auto-oscillator, what matters for the line width is how much stored energy you have in your system compared to KBT. And if you cannot drive your system to very high cone angles, to very high precession angles, your line width is very bad. And for some unknown reason at the moment is actually we cannot drive the system to very high angle of precession, usually it dies out as you increase the damping compensation. So the system starts to auto-oscillate and then dies out. And this is a behavior that is completely orthogonal to what was known in metallic system, where we could drive the system to very high angle of precession, okay? And we could increase very much the stored energy. So the fact that it dies out is actually a mystery. And this has been discovered. But what I want to show you now is that if you look at how much current you need to inject to compensate the damping, and you study it as a function of frequency, you see that this threshold current, so I'm sorry, the scale is inverted, you see that, of course, this current amount of current that you have to inject decreases as I decrease the magnetic field. When I decrease the magnetic field, I decrease the frequency. Since my broadening is proportional, roughly, at least at large frequency to frequency, I should decrease the amount of current that I inject in my system. But you see that above a certain point, it starts to increase again. So the fact that it starts to increase again shows you that actually the inhomogeneous part of the broadening become important. So again, I decrease the magnetic field, I decrease the frequency. But there is a point if I have a finite intercept where the amount of homogeneous broadening becomes smaller than the amount of inhomogeneous broadening. And the fact that you have still inhomogeneous broadening creates this enhancement of the damping inside your system. And you see that this enhancement actually strongly depends on the diameter. So as I go to higher diameter, I have another stronger enhancement of the amount of current to reach this auto-oscillation threshold. And this was the key why it was completely impossible to observe auto-oscillation or damping compensation in very large sample in millimetric sample. So basically what it says is that the amount of positive damping that you have is not only the homogeneous part of the damping that you need to compensate, but also the inhomogeneous part. All right, so this concludes my talk. So if I will summarize what is the take-home message. Okay, first, if you want to study Higgs, it's better to go to microstructure or nanostructure, okay? The damping will improve as you decrease the lateral size, and this comes from confinement effect. It's also very important to study it, in this case, in the perpendicular direction. So the field direction is very important because the way the magnon manifolds open up, it's only in the perpendicular direction that you have intrinsically only the homogeneous part of a broadening. And if you have an inhomogeneous part of a broadening, it participates in the effect of spin transfer. Why it does so? Okay, it's not solved, but actually it's not a mystery. I think it's known, by the way, the spin transfer is it's a stimulated emission process, and it's very close to what you will find in laser. So if you have degenerate modes inside your system, they will, through intermode coupling, participate, okay, to the coupling to the DC source. So as you inject angular momentum, for example, in the lowest energy mode, it will share this energy to these hidden modes. It will disappear, okay, also to these hidden modes. So you will have, the more you have hidden modes, the more you have to feed current to exceed, to exceed the natural damping of the mode that you are to pump. So this was the key, and so the inhomogeneous broadening is key also to spin transfer phenomena. This was not found before because in metallic system, usually this part is very small, okay? You are always dominated, the alpha being so big, you are always dominated by the homogeneous part. But in case of magnetic insulator, especially, for example, when you try to look at it at very low frequency, it becomes the dominant channel. Thank you.
Questions? So when you come to low field, the magnetization stops being uniform. Develop some texture, as you said.
Yeah.
When that happens, the spins that come in from the transfer torque are no longer anti-parallel to the magnetization, right? They're going to be coming in at some angle. And so there's sort of a cosine of that angle is going to be effective at sort of anti-damping. Did you take that sort of thing into
account? No. Okay. It's okay, you're right. So we only, okay, this is only assuming homogeneous, but the field, by the way, the field that we're applying here, look at it, and it's still 5 kilogauss, 500 gauss. For Yig has a very small magnetization, okay? It's about 2 kilogauss, the MS is 2 kilogauss, so we believe, yeah.
If I understood correctly, you said that the salt oscillation does not occur in very large Yig fields.
Okay. What I've said is that the amount of current that maybe I should step back again. So the very important thing about again this notion of spin-all effect is what it was regenerative. So basically the voltage, maybe I didn't emphasize this in my talk, but you see when you were doing the inverse spin-all effect in micro-sized discs, it was going down to the nanovolt regime. Okay? So the bigger is the size of the sample, the bigger is your DC signal when you do inverse spin-all effect. So that's why people started by using it on very big samples. And the question my point is, where do you reach the critical current for very large samples? So my point is, there is a critical current, but it's too large to be achieved experimentally. Okay? Because you have increased tremendously the number of degenerate modes, and you've increased so much the number of degenerate modes that actually the current that you need to inject is well above where platinum will vaporize. Okay? So by the way, okay, I should also emphasize a little bit. You can see in this picture that when I pass, so I pass roughly 10 milliamps in my system, but you can see that actually I've shifted by my spectra. So if you look at, for example, at the 1.5 kilogauss line, it goes, you know, along a parabola like this. And this is because the Yig heats, okay? As current is injected in the platinum through Joule effect, there's a thermal decrease of the spontaneous magnetization of Yig due to heating. And I can tell you that actually you heat the sample by about 50 degrees Celsius in this experiment already. Which is done, by the way, at room temperature.
I think in that experiment which you cited by Kajiwara in the Nature.
Yeah. Okay, so yeah.
I think there they did detect some ferromagnetic.
Okay, I didn't go in all the story. So it's part actually of, there was a report, okay, back in 2009 it was a Nature paper by a group in Sendai, claiming that indeed you could do auto-oscillation in macroscopic Yig using the inverse spin-all effect. So basically, we demonstrated what should be done. I don't want to too much go into that, but this is the real physics going on.
So I have a question. So is there so if these modes that come in play such a crucial role in damping, the size of the system, it's almost counterintuitive. You think that by patterning it smaller and smaller, the damping should go up. But you're finding that in fact it's the fact that you're cutting off these nodes.
No, okay. So first, you have to, okay. What's important is to, the system is a collective mode. Okay? So intrinsically, actually, it's immune. I mean, you can shift, for example, when you bring so compared to a paramagnetic system, I can bring a gradient of magnetic field near my tip, through my tip, near my sample. I'm not going to destroy the line width. Okay? I'm going to destroy the internal field, but it's going to still stay a collective mode. Okay, and so it's going to resonate at a different frequency, but you're not going to change the broadening. The reason why I'm changing the broadening in the experiment that I'm saying is that by doing asymmetry, I introduce some intermode dipolar coupling between the modes. So the mode that I excite becomes coupled to other modes, close in frequency, so they need to be close in frequency, and then participate, because there's two things that, you know, in coupling, When you do coupling, there's two things that are important. First, of course, the intermode coupling. You need to have intermode coupling. In principle, the intermode coupling is zero if you have a perfect disk, okay, with no asymmetry, because those hidden modes by the symmetry are immune, but I can break the symmetry and then recover a small intermode coupling. Now, of course, in experiment, what is this intermode coupling is maybe through imperfection in the circularity, through imperfection in the thickness, and so forth. But you need this intermode coupling, and then you need the closeness in frequency. Okay, to do a mode coupling, the mode needs to be nearly degenerate. So the mode will only couple to the presence of modes that are degenerate in frequency. And my point was to say that by working, you can work actually on quite large dimension on Higgs disk as long as you are in the perpendicular direction, because in the perpendicular direction, you are immune, completely immune to this degeneracy. And another thing is actually in the perpendicular direction, if you look at how the mode develops, if I go back, it takes actually a pinning at the, at the periphery. It's naturally, actually, for the dipolar interaction, it's naturally, it has zero precession at frequency. So you're not even probing what's going on. So basically, the frequency, if you think of it for a spin wave, what you are doing, if you calculate what's the link between the internal field and the frequency, it's basically what you are doing is you are probing the internal field on the precession amplitude of the spin wave. So if you have a node, you are basically not probing what's, fluctuation of internal field that you have there. So this mode will be completely immune to any perturbation that I will do at the periphery.
But can you, if you wanted to further improve the dissipation or the coupling between these modes, is it amenable to some of the ideas that
people are usually interested in what I'm saying through trying to decouple. So the take-home message for people, for example, who do quantum computing, and they want to do quantum. So there have been some experiments done on quantum computing using yttrium iron garnet. There is an experiment done in Tokyo University by Professor Nakamura. You use a Higgs sphere. Okay, it was key in this experiment that the Higgs was not on a substrate, not on GGG substrate. That was a very key feature, okay? And this, in this case, so by using a perfect sphere, okay, you will try to remove these two magnets by polishing the surface. You try to decrease this intermode coupling, okay, these two magnets scattering. If you want to do it now on a microstructure, for example, because your structure being a qubit, being a small size, you want to have the spin wave, you want to increase the overlap, you want to decrease, you want to increase the overlap, so you need to decrease also the volume of the magnetic system, and you want to do it on the microstructure, it's gonna be a key to dissociate the Higgs of a GGG, okay? And I can tell you already at liquid nitrogen, the enhancement of the damping that you will observe gig on GGG is about a factor of 10. Okay, so you really, even at liquid nitrogen, you completely, and this comes from, actually there is two things that are coming to play, the fact that you have a huge phonon bath in the GGG, and a second thing that comes into play, this is the key actually at low temperature, is the fact that the GGG is a paramagnet, so its susceptibility is gonna increase tremendously as you go down in temperature. Now, even if you have succeeded to separate the yeek from GGG, it's very important to work in the perpendicular geometry.
That's
no questions. Okay, so.
Maybe I should say, I think we need to also thank Rafi for organizing this conference. Because I mean, you've done a great, great job. And thank you for taking together the community and bringing us together here in Canada.
All right. Well, see you in 2 years. And I guess we haven't really discussed who's going to do this in 2 years. But that, I guess maybe we should do that offline. We'd like to continue this. So, yeah.
I think.
Thanks for everyone's participation and presence. I think it was very, very good. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Rafi.